Okay, so this is a new lesson about the software architecture course. The last lesson we were talking about service-oriented architectures. At the end of the lesson, we were talking about a variant of the service-oriented architectures, which is called service-based architecture. Service-based architecture is, I mean, is something that happens a lot of times in a pragmatic way, and it is the idea that you decompose the main architect, the main system, you decompose it in different services. You have different services for different domains. Most of the services are sharing a database, so there is a common database where they store information and query information from that service database. And there is also like an API layer or a user interface layer where you have the, so this is the web application. Some of these applications are single page applications where usually with React, for example, and then you have the different domains modeled as different web services, and then all of them are queried or are providing services to the user interface. So this is a very pragmatic style, and a lot of systems have been implemented with this structure. Okay, the elements of this service-based architecture are units that have been independently deployed, usually composed of different components. You have the user interface that is connecting with these units, and you have a shared database. Constraints is that these services are usually independently deployed, and they are usually big services. I mean, there is not. So this is going to be. I mean, I'm teaching this part today again because I already thought about this the last year, in the last lesson, because I want to contrast this with microservices. Microservices is the one that we are going to talk later. So here, these services are usually coarse-grained, so they are more big services. And usually you have the user interface can be divided, and there are different topologies for the user interface. And usually the database is shared by all of these services. The advantages and the challenges of this architecture. I mean, the advantage is that you can divide the development in these services. You can also implement these services using different programming languages and technologies. It is usually easy to do it very fast, and there are a lot of frameworks to create these architectures. And you also can have more availability and reliability because they are deployed independently, and you can focus on those parts. What are the challenges here? I mean, there's the challenge of how to. I mean, you have one problem with the database here because you depend a lot on a single database. So usually, this is like the bottleneck is this part of the database. I mean, in my experience, in a lot of real-life applications, the biggest or the most important part is usually the database, because at the end is where you want to store the data in some place, and usually that's something which is not easy to handle. And also you have the problem of how to evolve the different services, and if you one of these services is invoking elements from other service and you have a new version of the service, then you have to adapt to the change of one version of the service, and that's usually difficult. Usually services are a bit monolith, so that's usually one of the challenges here. And also another challenge is that you can see that there is like the this division of responsibilities is where you have the middleware is in the middle, the people who are the usually, for example, Java programmers are here in the middleware, in the business domain. Then you have the database administrators, which handle the database, and then you have the specialists in user interface, so the front-end developers. So that's as I said, this is a very pragmatic style, and it has been used in a lot of companies. And probably when you go to work for a company, you will see this kind of style in a lot of places. And also, as I said, a lot of frameworks, for example, Spring Boot provides this. I mean, it's not only Spring Boot, a lot of frameworks help you to create this kind of architectures. Okay, so that's why this is a very pragmatic architecture. But now we are going to talk about one of the architectural styles that I think it was in 2012 or 2013, when it started to appear and people started to talk about this microservices architecture. And this is one of the most trendy architectural styles nowadays. So I'm not sure if it is really nowadays or maybe 2 years ago. I mean, 2 years ago, in the software architecture subject, a lot of people, community, the software architecture community, a lot of people were talking about microservices and the architectural style of microservices. So this was something that a lot of people really enjoyed and thought that it was the future of all architectural styles was going to be to develop microservices. The reasons for that is that some big companies like Amazon or Netflix, they said that they were using microservices. So when those companies say that they are using microservices and they are successful, a lot of people think that if they want to be successful, they have to copy those architectural styles and they have to do the same. But there is also a drawback there, because even not every company is as important as those companies. So you also have to think, it's also important to think what is your application, your domain, what is your context before jumping and to say that you want to implement a microservices architecture. Okay, the main idea of microservices is that you will have services, but notice the difference between these services and the previous service-based architecture. Now these services, each of them doesn't share anything with the other services, and even the data is proprietary of this service. So each service is the owner of its own database. So this is the main difference between the previous service-based architecture. If I go back, this in the previous one, you have here a shared database, but now with microservices, each microservice handles its own data. So that's probably the main difference with other approaches, that each of the services will handle its own data. Each of them is focusing on a specific task, and they are highly uncoupled. I mean, they are only connecting with other services using the API. So this is also an important aspect of information hiding. Each service only exposes to the external a public API, and the rest of the implementation is hidden from the rest of the services. At the end, this is like the modularity of a traditional software system. You divide in different modules. Each of the modules has an interface. But another big important difference is that with microservices, any microservices is going to be independently deployed from the other services. Okay, so at the end, if you are implementing this microservice, you deploy it to any machine, this other service is deployed in another machine, and you, if you want to change something in this microservice, you can change it and you can deploy it again in another machine, and you can do that very fast. So one of the main aspects of microservices is that you can independently deploy and update each microservice without taking into account the other microservices. Okay, so you can build those microservices and deploy independently. So this is also very important. And this allows you to have like a ecosystem of microservices that each of them work independent from the other services. I mean, this is usually, and you can have teams that are focused on implementing one of those microservices. Last year, there was a talk by Diego Berrueta, who is who he studied here in the in our school, and he now is working as a senior engineer in Atlassian. Atlassian is the company that built, for example, Bitbucket. And in that company, for example, he was talking that they have thousands of microservices. So you can think that it is not that you have only one, I mean, you have only five microservices. They, some companies have even thousands of microservices. And it was funny, for example, that there he was talking about the life cycle of microservices, how some microservices, for example, they have the birth, they start their life, but they also have the death. So some microservices also die because maybe they are not longer used by other services. So there's also they also have to handle the life cycle of the microservices. So I think it was a very interesting talk last year. So if you want to look at it, it's very interesting. So I mean, the talk is here. If you go to the software architecture course, you have here the conferences, and this is the conference from last year. He's a principal engineer in Atlassian. You have the slides and the video and so on. So it has, as I said, he was talking how to scale thousands microservices, okay? So this was about microservices, the definition. This is the diagram again. The main element is the microservice, which has the database. So this is a very interesting, a very important aspect of microservices. I will talk later about what are the some structural decays of microservices that you have to also to take into account. Of course, a service can contain several modules, so that's why here in this diagram I put that you have the service, and the service can have different modules, and you have an API layer that offers a way to invoke the service from the outside, so you can invoke the service from other services and so on. Some constraints is that the services are distributed, so the connection is through the network, so you cannot invoke directly one service from the other, you have to go through the network. Each service has models a specific domain or a workflow, so you have, so this is usually aligned with domain-driven design, because in domain-driven design, if you remember, the first thing you do is you create a bounded context of the model in the model of you want to implement. So in that bounded context, you implement one microservice or several microservices. You also isolate the data from the external or the other system components, so there is no way to invoke from this service directly to the database. So if this service wants to invoke this database, he has to go to the API layer and invoke the other service. So this is the service that owns this database, and he has to invoke in this way. Why this is important? Because in this way, you can replace this database by another database very easily. And this is also another feature that allows you to, for example, if you want to create a service and you start with MongoDB, if you later want to change by MySQL, you can replace that by MySQL, and you can do that very, very easily. And there is another constraint is that there is no mediator, no orchestrator of the web services, so they each of them work independently, and that's all. So you don't have so that there is this possibility, and we will see later that some solutions they create these orchestrators that handle other web microservices, but that's something that starts to deviate from the microservices style. Some features and advantages of microservices is I will talk now one slide for each of them. So notice that I am giving more importance to microservices, and instead of having one slide for advantages and disadvantages and challenges all together, I am creating one slide for each of them because I think it's interesting this architectural style. So the first one is about technology heterogeneity, is that each microservice can be implemented in its own programming language. So for example, you can have this system that you have pictures, you have friends, and you have posts, and each of them can be implemented, one of them in Scala, another one in Node.js, in JavaScript, another one in Java. Each of them has its own database, and they are deployed independently. That's why I created this box. This box is the in UML, it represents a computational server, a computational node. So the idea is that each of the microservices is independently deployed, also independently implemented by different programming languages, and even using different databases, and that's not a problem. And also, as I said here, it is if you work in a company that they want to experiment, and imagine that you have one of the developers in the company likes very much Scala and GraphDB. He wants to say, "I will try to implement this part, the post handling in these technologies." You can facilitate that so that you have also this flexibility. And that's a feature. It can also be a problem because later you will have, imagine that that programmer goes to a different company and leaves you, and he is the only one who is programming in Scala, and then you don't have anyone that wants to maintain this code. So that could be another problem. But in general, if the interface is very well defined, you could even remove this microservice and change that implementation by another implementation, for example, in Java or whatever. There is also this concept related with microservices, which is resilience. Resilience is that if you have one of the microservices fails, and that failure is not scaling to the rest of the system, you can continue, you can carry on working, no problem, because at the end everything is continue working. Because at the end all those microservices are deployed independent from other from other microservices. For example, if you have this application here, if you have a system that needs to handle friends, pictures, posts, if this system fails, at least the users can keep continue querying about friends and the pictures and so on. And you can see this, for example, I mean, in some outages, for example, in Amazon, I remember some parts were not working, but other parts were working. Also in Netflix, I remember some, I mean, it's not very common, but sometimes they have problems, and you can see that you cannot do some actions, but you can do the other actions. For example, imagine in Amazon that you cannot buy new products, but you can query and see reviews of other products. Okay, so this is resilience, and this is very important because most of the time we are talking about applications which are web services, and they have to be alive most of the time. So this is very important that if something fails, other parts continue working. So this is the idea of this picture. Okay, about scalability is also that another important aspect of microservices is that if if you want the microservices to scale, imagine that you are working in one computer and you see that your application is not able to handle thousands of requests, and you need to scale and you want to replicate to another computer. If you are working with microservices, you can scale the parts of that system that are the most used by the users. So for example, imagine you have in this example here, imagine that most of the users go to create new posts, and this is the bottleneck, so you can duplicate the post part and have a lot of computational nodes created for the post part. But and this is the difference if in a monolith you would have to replicate all the system. So this is a picture. This is a picture I copied from another, I think it was from Martin Fowler's paper about microservices, where if you have, so this is in a monolith, if you have a monolith, you have all the modules are here. If you want to scale, what you do is you put this system in different computational nodes. For example, you create four computational nodes and you are duplicating the monolith in all of the nodes. So this is the way that you can scale. As you can see, maybe imagine that this module is not used a lot, because this one is only used not very often, but imagine that the other modules, for example, this one is used a lot. If you duplicate the whole monolith, notice that this module that is not used a lot is here, is replicated four times, but imagine that this one is not really necessary, while the orange one, which is really used a lot of times, is replicated also four times. So at the end, you are replicating the whole monolith in multiple services. With microservices, it's different, because you divide the functionality. So you divide the functionality in these blocks, these microservices. And if you want to scale, you have four machines, what you can do, for example, imagine here, you need this orange part and you put it in this computer four times, in this other computer, in this other computer also. So at the end, you have five versions of this microservice working. This green one also, you can have it here in three parts, but for example, this pink one is only replicated in one computer. So at the end, you can scale the system on demand. So you don't need to scale parts that are not used as often as other parts, okay? There is also this concept about independent deployability, and this is very important, because at the end, if you want to change a thing, a microservice, you can very easily do that change and deploy it immediately. And it's very important. If you are working with a monolith, you have to update the whole monolith, okay? So this also helps this part of continuous deployment. You can update the different parts continually, have the latest version working and running, because at the end it's an ecosystem of microservices. Also about organizational alignment, what I wanted to say here is that if you remember, the Conway law says that you have at the end, if you have an organizational structure, usually the architecture is a reflection, reflects that organizational structure. So there is if you remember, we were talking about this in the beginning of the course, about this maneuver where you try to go to inverse the Conway law. And what you do is you create the teams and the organizational structure to promote the desired architecture. So if you think before, what is the design, the desired architecture of your system, and then you assign teams to that architecture. So for example, if you have, imagine in this example, here. You think that you have this, you divide the application in these three microservices, and then you assign teams for each of these microservices. Okay, so that's the idea of the Conway of to work in this way. At the end, you create the teams following that modular decomposition, and this allows you to have what is called cross-functional teams, which are teams with different skills and different functionality, but that they are working in the specific domain that they want. Okay, this is also important. It's a concept called service ownership, which means that the team that owns a service is responsible for making changes to the service and also deploying this microservice. Okay, so this is also some years, I think 2 years ago, we had Sergio Fernandez from Amazon. He said that in Amazon, they say that if you build a microservice, you are responsible for running it. And also you are responsible also to keep the service alive. And for example, it must be 24/7, so you have, for example, they must be on call, so if there is a problem with the service, they are called maybe in the night, and they have to see what happened and to keep it running. Okay, but the main goal here and the main aspect here is that you have an increased autonomy, and also you have this speed of delivery, so you can very fast create new functionality and add new microservices without stopping and having to compile the rest of the application or the system. So this is again the same idea, is just with these pictures from the same article. So this is the traditional, the monolith applications. You have the people who are responsible of the user interface specialist. You have the middleware specialist. You also have the database administrators, and each of them is responsible of this part of the whole system. So at the end, you have what is called siloed functional teams, because they are specialized in all the database or the middleware, but they don't talk with other teams, and there are some communicational problems in this way. And this also leads to architectural applications that are siloed. So at the end, you have the database separated completely from the business and completely from the user interface. And if you have to do a change, most of the change have to go from imagine that you want to add new functionality, and you have to change the database, you also have to change the business, and you also have to change the user interface. Okay. And with microservices is different, because you can combine one specialist in user interface with one or two from middleware and another one or two database, and you put them in a team, and this team is going to be responsible from one microservice. This other thing is going to be responsible of another microservice, and this other thing of another microservice. So this is the way. So you have cross-functional teams, and they are organized around capabilities, around the different business domains, or and so on. Okay, so this is one important aspect of microservices. Another aspect of microservices is that you have the data management is decentralized, and you can use different database management systems. For example, and this is the same example as I said before, you can have if you have a monolith and you have one module that uses this database table, it can be a table in the database, another module is using this other database and another table, and this one another one. If you have microservices, you could have one microservice which is using the yellow one, the orange one, and the blue one. Okay, and you divide in different databases or different schemas. I have to say that I was looking to some big companies. Some big companies There is a trick here that you can have a whole database. For example, imagine you have a whole database which is Oracle or database management system. You have Oracle, but you divide the whole database in different schemas. So you, in, the nomenclature, I mean, how to name this is a bit tricky because each of them are called databases, and each database is inside a big database management system. Okay, so some companies have Oracle as the database management system, and inside they have separate databases that are are used by independent microservices. Okay, so this is some pattern that I also have seen in some companies. And finally, another advantage of microservices is that they can be optimized for replaceability. And this means that sometimes in some old and legacy systems, you have some components that nobody wants to touch. And I mean, this is something that happens in practice a lot of times, because sometimes it was developed maybe 15 years ago by one developer, that developer is no longer working at the company. The component works and you have a system that is working, but nobody wants to touch it. That's usually a problem, and that happens in some companies. With microservices, you can also have one microservice implemented by someone and nobody wants to touch it, but it's different because with microservices you have the interface of the microservice and it is hiding the implementation. So you can, in a way, if you know how is this interface, you can probably create a different implementation of that same interface and replace that old component. You can replace it by a new one. Okay, you can delete the new one and replace with a better implementation. You have less cost to do that than in other architectural styles where you have a component that nobody is able to do, and if you remove the component, everything is breaking. Okay, so these were some advantages of microservices. But of course, there are some challenges of microservices, and challenges. This year, as you know, in the seminar, we are going to have a talk about one team which is going to talk about the fallacies of microservices and the trade-offs of microservices. So this is a topic that I'm not going to talk too much, because some teams are going already to talk about this. And just an overview, I mean, you have the problem of how to manage lots of microservices. So if you have to manage a lot of microservices, you have this nanoservices anti-pattern, where it's a bit difficult. Also, usually it's difficult to know what is the state of the application. So at the end, the consistency of the application when it is based on microservices is a bit difficult to understand it. And also, at the end, you have a distributed system, and to manage a distributed system, you have all the problems of distributed systems. You have problems to take into account, like latency, the network, what is the message format, what is how to balance the load, fault tolerance, and so on. So you also have the problems of testing and deployment distributed systems. So there is a bit operational complexity. I mean, you have maybe you need Docker plus Kubernetes to manage all the distributed systems. So at the end, you are adding more complexity to your software system. Something that I have seen is a lot of companies that they want to use microservices because the only reason is because they are very trendy and they are used by Netflix or whatever. So this is also a problem. And there is a nice anti-pattern, which is called the distributed monolith. The distributed monolith is when you have a lot of, I mean, you have a monolith application and you try to decompose it in microservices, and at the end, but at the end it is still a monolith application, but now it is distributed. So you have the same problems that you had when you have a monolith, which is a lot of components which are highly coupled and they depend on other components, and so this everything is tangled, but now it is distributed. So you have the disadvantages of monoliths and also the disadvantages of microservices. So this is an anti-pattern which is interesting to know. And there is also, this is something I want to talk in the next slide, which is the structural decay, is when, I mean, what I have been talking is the ideal microservices architecture, but you can also have this decays, which means that it deviates from the ideal architectural style and they go to other architectural styles. Okay, so maybe what happens is when you have some dependencies between services, so you have some kind of orchestration also between the different requests, or you have a lot of communication between one service to other services, or also a lot of shared libraries. And finally, you have also one database. So at the end, you are coupling all the microservices to a single database. Okay. We are going, when we finish this part, we are going to watch this video. I wanted to watch with you this video. I will close to record this part. But before that, I want to finish. There is a variant about microservices which are called self-contained services. Self-contained systems. And the idea is that you separate the functionality into many independent systems, and each of them contains the logic and the data. So this was something that was already documented, and I just wanted to mention it. So now we are going to close this record.